you know, if we have to go to the most remote place in the world to get one species that is key for our study, we go there. And 99.9% of the times, we get it. Our expedition to the Amazon was interesting because we were going up the Rio Negro about 3 days north of Manaus by the river. And we were just sampling these spiders along the river. There's no roads, there's no airports, there's a few indigenous communities that live in the banks of the rivers. And we were actually living in a boat. That was our home, our kitchen, our lab. And from there, we were accessing different points of the inundated rainforest by little boats. And when we arrived there, we had a guide who will open a trail with a machete, get into the forest, sample some of these places probably no one had sampled before.
Because spiders have a fairly huge diversity of lifestyles, it means that you have to go to different parts of the forest at different times of the day, depending on what you're trying to collect or document. For example, many groups of spiders live in the leaf litter. You don't really know what they're doing because they're deep in the litter. And the only way to catch them is to actually collect the leaf litter and sift it with a sifter and get, you know, what comes out on a tray and collect the spiders. You don't really worry at all, you know, whether the spider will bite or not, because they will not. But in most cases, they're very small, so you don't actually collect the spider with your hands. You use a tool called a putter, which is basically a latex tube with a plastic tube at the end and a filter. You basically suck the spider into this tube and then blow it into the vial. In other cases, if you want to document the orb webs, these are usually built every night, so you want to be in the forest when it's beginning to get dark. They're beginning to build their webs, and at that point you can actually photograph freshly built orb webs. What we traditionally do is we dust those webs first with cornstarch to make the webs visible. This will reveal the web architecture. We will photograph that. Remember that in many of these cases, this web architecture has never been described. So it's important to document that. And once you have the web, you know that the spider is out there. So now you can actually go and collect the spider alive. It's very important to actually have specimens that link that particular photograph of the web. You can actually then take the specimen to the lab and provide an identification.
Normally, when we're in remote locations, we cannot bring the specimens alive. And we preserve them on a liquid that is called RNA later, that preserves the RNA. So often when we're in the field, we collect the specimens, then we bring them into our rooms or mini labs, whatever we've been able to set up, look at them in the microscopes, identify them, and then we preserve them in RNA later. And as soon as we bring them back into the lab, then we catalog them first thing, and then we accession them and put them into the freezers or into the cryo collection. A cryo collection is a library of tissues, the best way that we can preserve those tissues to make sure that in the future we have access to the same genetic resources pretty much that we will have had with the live specimen. The reason for that is that the temperature is very low. That temperature is about -196 Celsius, which is about 321 negative Fahrenheit. The reason why it needs to be that cold is that at those low temperatures, any of the chemical reactions that will result into degradation of DNA or RNA, they just basically stop. And that ensures long-term preservation of all the proteins and the DNA and the RNA of those specimens. So this is the gold standard nowadays for preserving these specimens in the long term. Many of these environments are going by fast, and we don't know if in the future we're going to be able to collect again there. We don't know if in the future that forest is going to exist. And since many of these species actually have very narrow ranges of distribution, it might be that when a given forest disappears, the species that once lived there also are gone. So bringing some of these specimens back into the museum is also a way to ensure that we have at least preserved something of that biodiversity.